Hi, you're listening to episode 58 of the Reading Cove Book Club's podcast. If you're a book lover who may be interested in joining our online book club, please visit our website at thereadingcove.com. For September 2015, we're discussing Swimming Lessons by Mary Alice Monroe. So hi, I'm Millenia in Florida.
And I'm Roberta in Georgia.
And Roberta and I are two members of the Reading Cove here to discuss our September 2015 Cove pick, which is Swimming Lessons by Mary Alice Monroe, our 178th Cove pick chosen by Roberta.
Yay.
In Georgia. So we're starting our discussion today. What'd you think?
Well, here it was my pick, but I was a little disappointed. Well, I read books by the same author, and I really enjoyed them and gave them much higher grades.
Me too, yeah.
And so I was just sort of disappointed in this one that I know that this is part of a series, but it's set up mainly as a standalone. Mm-hmm. But I think the author had too many different storylines still of these people that from the other books, and really she didn't need to go into as much, but she needed to give a little bit more background on them so we knew who they were. Mm-hmm. and how they affected the current people. And then the biggest thing, I guess, that bothered me is I'm all for wildlife rescue and rehabilitation, and these people do a wonderful job in these different places, South Carolina and other places. But it just seemed like there was too much stuff about turtles. Mm-hmm. and not very much at all about these human relationships. You just didn't feel like you knew as much about what was going on with them.
Right.
Human characters. And it's always good to learn some new things about animals or history. Mm-hmm. Or whatever, but I just felt like I knew way too much about these turtles and not enough about what was going on with the characters.
Yes, which in my experience made it boring.
Right.
You know, I was disappointed in it because I felt like it read like an old-fashioned romance novel I might have read when I was 12.
Right.
Featuring, you know, sea turtles. Or, you know. The first half was very boring for me. I struggled. I had to skim, you know. And only because it was a pick did I stick it out. Otherwise, I would have chucked it. And I wasn't interested in the sea turtles. I suppose people who are interested in that might find it much more interesting. But this didn't do anything to develop an interest for me in sea turtles.
Right.
And I think that was where it failed me, because I could have become more interested if it had been more interesting, because she did try to do a parallel between the sea turtle that Toy, that's the other thing. We'll get to the names in a minute.
Right.
That Toy found on the beach with her daughter, and the recovery of this near-dead turtle who was full of leeches and just disgustingly described. I was like, ugh. And
TMI.
I know. I was like, and then she kept repeating how the thing was covered in this. I was like, ew. So then she was drawing a parallel between Toy's journey and the journey of the turtle back to health and being released back into the sea. So
right.
I can appreciate that, but it still did nothing to make me more interested in sea turtles and loggerheads or whatever.
Right.
But you do learn a lot about it, you know, from the story. I don't know. I felt the writing and the plot felt really sophomore type of thing. And the tension, there was no tension really, because I was never, when the little girl, Little Lovey,
yeah.
was kidnapped, or not kidnapped, but she was gone. The father took her and then he couldn't bring her back because the what's her name? Was in the hospital and couldn't meet him. And so everybody thought that she was kidnapped. So anyway, when we didn't know that he wasn't trying to kidnap her, I still didn't feel any tension.
Right.
I wasn't ever really worried that something was going to happen. And
yeah.
I think that's what it missed.
If they had wanted to use him like that, you could almost have been more suspenseful if
mm-hmm.
it looked like he was going
exactly.
to, you know, kidnap her, but then something happened, you know, something needed to happen where he thought, no, no, I can't do this. And, you know, he dropped her off again.
But. Right. And that may have been too predictable. Like if he really was, you know, oh, I'm going to take her, then
yeah.
we would have said it's too predictable. But so the fact that he didn't mean any harm, and then, you know, some of his problems were exposed by it, by them calling the police, and, oh, he has this statutory rape thing out in California. So he's now acting out of fear by not bringing her back.
Right.
That part was good, but I think it could have been handled better where we felt more fear about her well-being.
Right.
That was supposed to be the whole point.
Right.
And then Toy happens to be off in the Caribbean or wherever she went.
Costa Rica. Yeah.
And not being able to get the phone call, you know, where the hell were you that they couldn't get a message to you that this was happening, you know? And then her relationship with Ethan, there was absolutely no spark there for me. I felt no chemistry or interest in their relationship. It was just like, whatever.
Yeah.
And then the names were so cheesy and too on the nose. It's like, what, Toy? Why is her name Toy?
I know. I never understood that.
And then Little Lovey and Miss Lovey, and it's just too on the nose.
Yeah.
Like, you're trying to be so cutesy, and it's like, whatever. The comments from everyone else in the group, I don't know. Has anybody said they've enjoyed it? Cheryl.
Yeah.
I think Cheryl said she was enjoying the sea turtle stuff. I'm not sure anyone else is. I think most of the comments were like boredom.
Right.
For the first half. Nicole said it got better in the second half, which I agree. It got a little more interesting.
Yeah. Right.
It did. It did pull you in a little bit more in the second last half of it.
But like I said, I expected it to be more like some of her earlier books. And I guess you shouldn't put certain expectations on things because hopefully most authors, each book's going to be a little bit different.
Yeah. Mary Alice Monroe, you know, I recommend most is, the one I recommend most is Sweetgrass.
Right, right.
I really enjoyed that book. And some of them have been hit or miss. We've read The Book Club.
Right.
Which I think was well enjoyed. So she's more of a hit author, for me, I think, than a miss. But sometimes when she goes off into these special interest based stories, like this one's based around, you know, the sea turtles. I read another one by her that was based around birds.
Right.
And I had the same issue. I was bored. I don't feel like she finds a way to make it all that interesting to people who aren't already interested in that.
Right.
And it's well reviewed, I must say.
Oh, yeah. Because
when it was, when you first picked it and I went and looked at the reviews and everything, it's like over 4 stars on Amazon.
I know. Surprised.
Well, there are enough people out there who enjoy it.
Yeah.
So that's good.
And I mean, and like she said, she has a lot of fans. I think especially people who like the low country of South Carolina, because, you know, that's a really kind of a neat place. It has a lot of history and things people can relate to.
Right.
But like I said, you can't be 100% sure just because of the reviews, because people do have conflicting visions of stuff, because a book that our member Cheryl picked for the bonus book this past time, Embers, I enjoyed it. It wasn't the best thing I read, but I enjoyed it. But I was looking on Goodreads to see about what people thought, and it averaged out to only like 2 point something. I thought, whoa, there were some real haters in there.
Wow.
So you never know, you know, even if something sells a good many copies, there's still going to be the people out there for one reason or another. They just, you know, don't care for it.
Right.
Yeah, the only other thing I was thinking about is, I know Toy didn't come from the world's greatest, you know, home life or background, but she basically seemed like a very intelligent woman that, despite intelligent and less than...
Well, her mother was awful. Oh, yeah, we didn't talk about her mother.
Terrible.
Wow.
Oh, her mother's just, you know, that's the kind of things people fear. It's like she's even the regular mother, not like the evil stepmother, but just the evil mother. It's just, she was awful. But at the same time that you'd think after the Toy had seen all this stuff all this had happened, I could see in somebody in that situation where they have a really bad home life, a lot of times they tend to go out there, you know, looking for love, but it's in all the wrong places, but they're just looking for someone to love them and be there with them. But it just seemed like even for her bad situation, that Darryl was just way below toy, you know, in so many ways, you know, intellectually and other things. He was just sort of a redneck who could sing a little bit.
Just didn't have the drive to overcome the adverse or the stumbling blocks that happened to everyone.
Right.
He just saw everything as, you know, oh, see, nothing ever works out for me, and wants to complain when
right.
he doesn't achieve instead of going after it again. Dust yourself up, keep going.
Right.
He was that type of person.
But yeah, and I said he just, you even wonder why did he come back to see Toy and his daughter after all this time. But I think it's just more like he was in a down, you know, slide again financially and otherwise. So maybe he just thought he could move in with them and have some support. Cause,
well, he had to get away from the California problem.
Well, yeah, that you know, that bad thing too, but just in general, why he came specifically to Toy. But I think it's also because he used up all of his chances with his mother, you know. It was his mother. She knew how he was too. That
she had enough of him.
Yeah, she was and everything, so. And Toy was so worried about losing custody of little Lovey, but I don't think any judge with, you know, who had a half a sense would give the daughter to him, because
no.
he just has a really bad reputation, much less this thing about this statutory, you know, possible statutory rape thing. He just, you know, is just not the kind of guy you want raising a young, sweet girl.
No, and Toy was young herself.
Right.
And just trying to, was just learning basically how to be a mom.
Right.
And how to be confident and secure in herself as a woman.
Right.
So, and having just lost Miss Lovey.
Right.
It was a new period in her life. And that's what I think was being illustrated with the turtle.
Right. That she had to let go of some things and be able to be a little bit more independent, find her own way. And it seemed like she was.
And heal.
Yeah, and heal from everything that had happened. So.
Mm-hmm. And her mom, I mean, when she went to her mother and it was all that was revealed, like why they don't speak or why they don't have a good relationship, I just thought that's, you know, that's a huge thing for a Toy or anyone when your mom is that person who would say, you were asking for it, you know, that you, he was, it wasn't his fault. It's your fault. And your daughter's missing because it's you, because of you, it's your own fault. And it's just like, oh my God, she has to, you know, really overcome that
kind of attitude.
Yeah. And the fact that it's your mother. So you cannot have a relationship with that woman.
No.
Unless she gets help and changes, that you'll never be able to have a relationship with her.
If Toy's mom is capable of really changing, I think Toy's the one that's just going to have to be, you know, as much as it hurt, let her go and then go on with her
life. Yeah.
Her life with Ethan and with Kara and her husband.
Right.
People like that who, and Flo too. People that really and truly do love her and care for her and, you know, help her out when she's in a pinch.
Exactly.
So you sometimes have to make your own little family like that, because your quote real one or your biological one is not doing you any favors, not doing you any good, but it's got to be very painful.
Yeah, and I must say I did like Kara.
Yeah.
Who was struggling to have a child of her own. I did like how she was very supportive and very faithful, I guess,
to Toy,
because when her brother was trying to force her to, like, say, you could be making a lot more rent on this place and than what you're making, and that'll benefit you. And he was making a good point, like, you know, how long are you going to have her here living almost, you know, from next to nothing?
Yeah.
And she refused to hear it or to change anything.
Yeah.
And I thought, I like that. I thought that, you know, that loyalty, that's the word I was looking for.
Yeah, loyalty.
Loyalty to Toy and, you know, as an extension of her mom and what Toy meant to her mom.
Right.
I liked that. And, you know, that's exactly what someone like Toy who has, you know, who's now motherless.
Right.
That's exactly the kind of support she needed to get on her own two feet.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. To see that there are people there willing to help her and just not, you know, think, well, sorry, can't help you. Got to take care of my own, you know, personal needs here.
Exactly.
Yeah, I did like that part. So.
Yeah, and her problems, you know, with her fertility, that was sad. And that's why she loved little Lovey so much.
Right.
And I was concerned there for a bit when she wasn't approving of Toy allowing Daryl back in the picture.
Yeah.
Kara wasn't. And I kind of thought, oh no, I hope she's not gonna like tell her she can't live there if she
Right.
and I'm glad that she did that did not happen. Like she
No.
didn't go in that direction.
And you could see her feeling that way too. Like you're
Yes.
saying, even though we're glad it didn't happen that way, you could see her feeling that way because pretty much that Daryl had just flown the coop. So,
Yep.
most some people would say, well, you just don't need to let him back in your life because he did, nothing to help you before. And the way it looked, I don't think she was going to be seeing any child support out of that man for any time in the near future, if ever. I think it was good for Lovey to see Daryl because at least that way she, he may not be the best one, but at least she saw this is my father and this is what happened and just, wouldn't mess her up down the road thinking, well, where's my father? Why didn't he ever come to see me?
Well,
And
he was in California, you know? No,
yeah.
I agreed with Toy. I actually did agree with the what she did,
Yeah.
saying that I don't want, I'm not going to stop him from getting to know his daughter.
Right.
I want her to know her father, that she does have a father, and here he is. And her breaking up with Evan or Ethan,
Yeah.
that kind of, I understood that she felt that's what she needed to do
Right.
because she obviously still had unfinished business
Right.
with Daryl, like in terms of her emotions, like did she still love him? Clearly she still knew he wasn't somebody that she should be hitching her post to.
Right.
But she still had some unresolved feelings, and so she pushed off, Ethan. And I was just like, okay, I get that. I guess I understand why she would feel that
Oh yeah,
she can't deal with both of it at, both of them at the same time right now.
that she just had to, kind of take a step back so she could get everything resolved in her own, mind and how she felt, because otherwise she'd always probably be really torn and not sure if she'd made the right decision.
And then Ethan at the end took a real chance at, just kind of inserting himself and saying, I'm not letting you push me away.
Right.
Because she tried to do it again, and he
Yeah.
was like, okay, I'm not having it. That can be a really good thing, like it ended up being in this book, or it can be a really bad thing.
That could have gone either way.
Exactly.
But then, you see he really is a man of who cares and has integrity and when he says he's going to do something, he'll
He
do
does
it.
it right.
He's more in touch with everyday reality. So you have to like that. To accept a child from someone else's previous
Oh,
marriage.
yeah, absolutely.
Of course, she sa sounded like she was just absolutely charming. So,
Adorable,
yeah, adorable. So it'd be kind of hard not to be charmed by her. It wasn't like she was some of these little bratty kids you think, oh no, what
Exactly.
have I gotten myself into?
Right. Yeah, so that's our discussion of Sweet Misfortune by Kevin Allen Milne. Thanks for tuning in and come back again next time. We'll be discussing The Girl with All the Gifts by M.R. Carey. Have a good one. Bye.
Bye.